بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، فإن أحسن الكلام كلام الله، وخير الهدى هدى محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وإن شر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. This is our fifth lesson on Al-Aqidah Al-Tahawiyyah. And in the previous lesson, we looked at the statement of Imam Al-Tahawi rahimahullah in relation to the eternity of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so Imam Al-Tahawi said, قَدِيمٌ بِلَا ابْتِدَاء دَائِمٌ بِلَا انْتِهَاء, that Allah is eternal without beginning and everlasting without end. And so we mentioned in that lesson a few issues pertaining to the word or to the name قَدِيم, and how if it's used as a description, it is fine, but if it's used as a name, as is done by some of the mutakallimeen, those people who spoke about Allah based upon theological speculation, what we call ilm al-kalam, then this is a mistake. And also because the word qadim, it means that which precedes something else. Right? So it doesn't necessarily mean that it is that Allah is the one who is the first, because in the Quran we see the name of Allah used is Al-Awwal. And so there is a deficiency in this word Al-Qadim in the sense, from the point of view of the meaning, that it doesn't really convey the meaning that is found in the name of Allah Al-Awwal. So for this reason, Imam Al-Tahawi, he added a phrase, Qadimun bila ibtida. Qadimun bila ibtida. So essentially the meaning comes to be the same as Al-Awwal, and we stated in that lesson that this type of wording is from the wording of Ahlul Kalam, then it should really be avoided, and the correct name for Allah or the correct usage should be to refer to Allah as Al-Awwal, the first, before whom there is none. And so today's lesson we will look at the next two statements, and the first of those two statements is really a continuation of the statement that we looked at last week. And so this next statement, لا يفنى ولا يبيد, لا يفنى ولا يبيد, which means that he does not perish, Allah does not perish. The word يفنى, لا يفنى, he does not perish, ولا يبيد, has the same meaning. The word يبيد has the same meaning, to perish. So here, Sheikh Saleh Al-Fawzan, حفظه الله, he has some brief commentary upon this, and he says that here al-fana, which means to perish, and likewise wala yafna wala yabid, they actually have the same meaning. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is described with everlasting life in the Quran, al-hayah, al-baqiyah, al-da'imah, which is everlasting life. Allah says wa tawakkal 'ala al-hayy alladhi la yamut, that place your reliance upon the one who is ever living, the one who never dies. And so al-fana, this perishing, is something that never comes upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah says in the Quran, and there are other verses in the Quran which are a proof for this statement, which is Allah says kullu shay'in halikun illa wajhah, that everything will perish except his face. Surah Al-Qasas, Surah 28, verse 88. And likewise Allah says in Surah الرحمن كل من عليها فان ويبقى وجه ربك ذو الجلال والإكرام, that everyone upon it, meaning the earth, shall perish, and there will remain the face of your Lord full of majesty and honor, full of majesty and honor. Surah الرحمن, Surah 55, verse 26-27. So the Shaykh says that to Allah therefore belongs al-baqa, which is that Allah is everlasting. However, the creation are the ones who will die and they will be raised, and they were initially absent or non-existent, And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created them and brought them into existence. And then Allah will cause them to die again. They will die again. And then He will raise them once more. And so this shows that this quality of never perishing, then it is unique to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because He does not have any beginning and nor does He have any end. As we mentioned in the previous statement of Imam al-Tahawi, the one before that, قَدِيمٌ بِلَا ابْتِدَاءَ دَائِمٌ بِلَا انْتِهَاءَ. And so this statement here, وَلَا يَفْنَى وَلَا يَبِيدْ, this is, if you like, an additional emphasis upon the previous statement. As for Shaykh Salih al-Sheikh, then he says that with this statement, Imam al-Tahawi rahimahullah, he intends two things. There are two issues he intends. The first one is that this adds emphasis, or it gives additional meaning and connection to Allah's complete life, Allah's perfect life, and Allah's complete self-sufficiency. The fact that Allah is self-sufficient, meaning Al-Qayyum, and Allah is ever-living, Al-Hayy, that this statement, وَلَا يَفْنَى وَلَا يَبِيد, that Allah does not perish, that this gives some additional meaning, and it is a further explanation of the statement that came before it. دَائِمٌ بِلَا انْتِهَى, that Allah is everlasting, who never ends. That's the first thing. That's the first purpose or intent behind this particular statement of Imam al-Tahawi. And the second point here is, and the second reason why this statement is made, is that some of the people of innovation, some of the Ahlul Bidah, they claimed that Allah's attributes come to an end, or some of Allah's attributes come to an end, and that they perish. And so, or even some of the effects of Allah's names, meaning some of the things which follow on from Allah's names, like for example, Allah's mercy, that the effects, Allah's name of Ar-Rahman or Ar-Rahim, his mercy, that the effects of that will come to an end, that they will expire and finish. So, the Shaykh says, as for our view, we say absolutely that Allah and His names and His attributes and His actions, that they never come to an end. They are eternal, without a beginning, and they never come to an end. And this is different to, again, the people we are speaking of here are the same people we mentioned in last week's lesson, the mutakallimeen or the mutakallimoon. And these are the people who began to speak about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala based upon what we call ilm al-kalam. And this ilm al-kalam is something really that the nations before the Muslims, like the Jews and the Christians, they indulged in that as well. They also spoke about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala based upon this ilm al-kalam. And you see amongst the Jews and the Christians the very same issues that they were discussing about Allah's names, about Allah's attributes, about Al-Qadr. And so these were found amongst them. And this ilm al-kalam itself has its origins in the language and the philosophy and the logic of the Greek philosopher Aristotle. So they began to incorporate his language and his classification of things, and then began to speak about Allah in that manner. So this was the Jews and the Christians, and then the same thing came to the Muslims, and when they brought this ilm al-kalam, what they intended to do with this ilm al-kalam was to try to prove Allah's existence, to prove that Allah exists. And so they formulated a proof, and this proof, what they basically argued, was that everything in the creation that we see is a body, is a substance, and it has certain attributes, it has certain qualities. And then they said that the qualities in things cannot exist on their own. So for example, you never see the color green walking down the street, and nor do you see a headache. You can't point to a headache. Rather, these are things what we call as attributes or temporary things which occur. So what they argued was that these things cannot exist on their own. they have to be in a body, or they have to manifest themselves in a body. So for example, the color green doesn't exist. You can't see the color green walking. Rather, you will only see it, like that chair over there is the color green. And so it has to be in a body. Likewise, a headache has to be in a person. It can't exist in itself. So the first thing they said was that everything in existence is either is a body, or it is an incidental attribute, an attribute or a quality. Then they said, attributes and qualities cannot exist on their own. Like what I've just explained, you don't see headache walking down the street, you don't see the color green walking down the street. These are all, you don't see smells and tastes walking down the street. All of these things are qualities of other things. Then they said that because these things cannot exist on their own, they must have had a beginning. They must have had a beginning. And then they said that because these attributed qualities which are found in things had a beginning, then the things in which they are found must also have had a beginning. Right? So they argued in this manner. Then basically what they were trying to do was to prove that the whole of the universe and everything in the universe, every single body and every single element of it, had a beginning at some point in time. Right, so they're basically trying to prove that the universe has a beginning. Now, one of the consequences, or one of the principles they needed in order to make this proof work, is that they said that eternal events in the past, or an endless chain of events in the past, are impossible. Right, so they said it's impossible to have an endless chain of events going back into eternity. Right, so this is really the foundation upon which some of these mutakallimeen, these Ahlul Bidah, why some of them said that some of Allah's attributes have a beginning, and others said that some of Allah's attributes have an end. Some of Allah's attributes will finish. This is the principle upon which they began to make the likes of these claims about Allah's attribute. So one group is called we can begin with the Jahmiyyah. And the Jahmiyyah, they said that an endless chain of events in the past is impossible, and an endless chain of events in the future is impossible. Right? So the implication of this was that the Jahmiyyah, or Jahm bin Safwan, said that there must be a point at some time in the future where paradise and hellfire will come to an end. Why? Because an endless chain of events in the future is impossible. Right? And so the effects of Allah's mercy, or the effects of Allah's punishment, must at some point come to an end, and because an endless chain of events in the future is impossible. So he was of the opinion that paradise will perish and hellfire will perish. And then there were some other people amongst the mutakallimeen, the Mu'tazila. They just said that there will come a point at which the people in hellfire will freeze. Everything will come to there will be no motion. Everything will just stop. And they will just, so whatever position the people in hellfire are in, they will stop right like that, and that will, and nothing else will happen thereafter. Again, this is all based upon this false principle that an endless chain of events in the future, an endless chain of events in the past, is impossible. And the reason why they made or invented or spoke of this principle, because it allowed them to construct this proof by which they believed they could argue against the atheists and prove Allah's existence. But this principle is false. And likewise, we see that another group called the Karramiyya, these people, they claimed that Allah's attributes, or some of Allah's attributes, must have a beginning. Meaning that Allah existed for a period without having certain attributes, like for example speech. And then Allah became one who was able to speak, or Allah became one who spoke. And the reason for this is because that if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was eternally always one who spoke whenever he willed, this would mean an endless chain of events in the past. This would mean that Allah has always been speaking and can always speak, and because speech is tied to his will and power, then it would mean an endless chain of events going into past and infinity. Right? So this is something that would disagree with their proof. It wouldn't allow their proof to stand, you know, to hold water. So for that reason they said that Allah existed for a while, and at some point he brought in himself the ability to speak. He brought in himself the attribute of speech. And again, so according to them, it means that Allah's attributes had a beginning. So in either of these two situations, we see that the benefit in what Imam al-Tahawi said, وَلَا يَفْنَى وَلَا يَبِيد, that Allah never perishes, even though he is speaking here of the future, and he's speaking about that Allah's essence and nor his attributes, that they will never perish, then also it also applies to Allah, you know, in terms of the beginning, in terms of whether Allah's attributes have a beginning. And this, inshallah ta'ala, he will discuss in the next couple of statements that will come shortly, inshallah ta'ala, or after a short while. But we need to be aware of both of these two things, that Allah's attributes neither have a beginning, and nor do his attributes have an end. Just like his essence does not have a beginning, nor does it have an end. Just like his names do not have a beginning, and nor will they perish. He has never ceased to exist with his names and with his attributes, and as one who does whatever he wills and who speaks with whatever he wills whenever he wills. This is what we believe about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the deviation in this field came from these people, as we said before, the mutakallimeen, those people who spoke about Allah based upon ignorance, based upon ilm al-kalam, and then they try to devise a proof to prove Allah's existence. And this proof, in order for it to be valid, then they required this principle that an endless chain of events in the past is impossible. And some of them said an endless chain of events in the future is impossible. On account of these two principles, some of them said that Allah's attributes had a beginning, like the Karramiyya, and others said that Allah's attributes will come to an end, or the manifestations, or the effects from Allah's attributes, like Allah's mercy, for example, or Allah's punishment, that this will come to an end. And all of this is a mistake and is an error. So the Shaykh says after this that we therefore don't define Allah's names and attributes and restrict them to any particular time. Rather, we apply this statement absolutely, that Allah has never ceased and will never cease with his names, attributes, and his actions. We apply this absolutely, and we don't make any limitations or restrictions in this regard. And so therefore, the saying of Imam al-Tahawi, وَلَا يَفْنَى وَلَا يَبِيد, this indicates the complete perfection of Allah's rububiyya, and the complete perfection in Allah's life. He is al-hay, and likewise in his self-sufficiency, the fact that he is self-sustaining, and he sustains everything which is besides him, meaning that he is al-qayyum. This indicates the perfection in Allah's names, al-hay and al-qayyum. So this is the end of the statement, وَلَا يَفْنَى وَلَا يَبِيدْ. And as we said, this really is a further clarification and an additional emphasis of the statement that came before it, دَائِمٌ بِلَا intiha. Allah is everlasting without end. And so the next statement is the saying of Imam al-Tahawi, وَلَا يَكُونُ إِلَّا مَا يُرِيدْ. وَلَا يَكُونُ إِلَّا مَا يُرِيدْ. That nothing occurs except what he desires, except what he wishes. وَلَا يَكُونُ إِلَّا مَا يُرِيدْ. And so the Shaykh Salih Al-Fawzan, hafizahullah, he says that in this statement we see the affirmation of two things. There are two things indicated in this statement. Number one, Al-Qadr, the affirmation of Al-Qadr. And number two, the affirmation of the attribute of Al-Irada for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Al-Irada, we can translate it as wish or desire. Wish is probably the best word. The wish. And so these two things are indicated in the statement, وَلَا يَكُونُ إِلَّا مَا يُرِيدُ, that nothing occurs except what he wishes. And this means that nothing occurs in Allah's dominion, in His creation. No event takes place. Nothing takes place except that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has wished it. Allah has desired it. Allah has wanted it to be. And the proof for this is the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran, in Surah Yasin, right at the very end, verse 82, Allah says, إِنَّمَا أَمْرُهُ إِذَا أَرَادَ شَيْئًا أَنْ يَقُولَ لَهُ كُنْ فَيَكُونَ. That indeed his affair or his command is such, his command is such that when he wishes something, when he desires something, that all he has to say is be and it is. Be and it is. So this means that every single goodness, everything which is khair, and everything which is evil, then all of it is through Allah's irada. Through Allah's irada. Through Allah's wish. And nothing comes out of Allah's wish. There is nothing that escapes or is independent of Allah's wish. And the Shaykh says that this statement here is a refutation of the Qadariya. It is a refutation of the Qadariya. And the Qadariya are the ones who began to deny Al-Qadr. They began to claim that the servant, that each one of us, for example, that he creates his own actions outside of Allah's creative power and outside of Allah's wish. They said that the man is the creator of his own actions. And the reason why they said this, to explain very quickly, is that they said that when a person commits an evil deed, when a person commits something which is evil, then how can Allah punish someone whom he forced to do an evil deed? Okay? And then they thought that this conflicts with the idea of justice, the idea of justice, the al-adl. And so therefore they said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that although He wills things and He gives men the capacity, it is men who themselves create their own actions. And it is only then that man can be punished for what he does, for the evil that he does. In other words, they had a wrong idea of what is justice. And with this wrong idea, they then thought that man, he creates his own actions, and only then can he be held responsible for that. And so this really was the foundation of the mistake of the Qadariya. And we see that this innovation is not something which has disappeared. You know, this is, rather we find it present in books today amongst the people, or amongst people or groups who claim to be involved in da'wah. So we see, for example, the founder of Hizb al-Tahrir, he is Taqiyuddin al-Nabahani, that in his books, Shakhsiya Islamiya, we find him outlining this very same innovation of the Qadariya, one of the first four major innovations which occurred in the Ummah, the innovation of the Khawarij, the innovation of the Rafida, the innovation of the Qadariya, and innovation of the Murjiya. And the Qadariya, the Messenger ﷺ, he spoke about them and he said that they are the Majus of this Ummah, the Majins of this Ummah. So anyway, this was the foundation upon which they spoke of this innovation. And what we say, and in fact the reality of this issue will become clear when we explain it in a bit more detail from the speech of Sheikh Salih al-Sheikh. But basically we believe that every single thing which happens, whether it is man's evil deeds, whether it is man's good deeds, then all of it arises and occurs out of Allah's will and Allah's wish. And so one of the effects of this innovation is that it ascribes inability to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It ascribes the fact that there is something within Allah's creation that Allah does not have control or power over. And this is false and it is rejected. And it means that things occur within Allah's creation which He has not wished. And this, as we said, is removing from Allah his power and his control and his complete domination over his creation. And then the Shaykh explains as well that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he creates evil and when he creates good, in other words, when he brings about evil, when he brings about good, then all of that is for a wisdom. There is a wisdom behind everything that Allah wishes, everything which Allah wills. So, from the point of view, so for example, from the point of view of evil, as it relates to us, then something is evil as it relates to us. But as it relates to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when Allah brings about evil, meaning in terms of his action, then his action, there is nothing but perfect wisdom and justice behind his action. To help you, to illustrate, to give an example, the example which is usually given is, let's say for example you have an illness or some sort of problem, and you go to the doctor, and the doctor requires that you need to be, surgery needs to be done, and you need to be cut, for example, let's say your chest needs to be opened, so he needs to cut open your chest, then you need to be given, you know, whatever treatment. Now, this, as it relates to you, as it relates to you as an individual, and the pain that you feel, and the harm that you feel, and the stress that you go through, all of this is no doubt evil to you. However, the action of the doctor, in the fact that the doctor is actually performing the action, this action, then in that there is a benefit, and there is a wisdom. So things can be looked at in two different ways. One in terms of the patient, and one in terms of the action of the doctor. And this example is usually the example given, this example is given by Shaykh Ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah. And so, to help us understand the idea, that when it comes to things which take place in the creation, which we see to be evil, then they are evil as it relates to us. But as it relates to Allah's action of wishing that thing, and bringing that thing into existence, and making the action to happen, then there is a wisdom behind that, and there is nothing but goodness as it relates to Allah's action that is behind that. But as it relates to the creation, then it is obviously evil as it relates to us. And we can apply this principle in many different ways. To give you one illustration, imagine a thief or a robber, for example. We find someone steals the property of other people, or maybe he harms other people, he oppresses them, he harms them in their wealth, or he harms them in their body and injures them. So now the fact that Allah wished and willed this to occur, then as it relates to Allah, we say that there is some wisdom behind these affairs that take place. Allah wished them, no doubt he wished them, and they took place. But there is some wisdom behind these affairs taking place. So as it relates to Allah, we don't say that this is an evil action. Rather, we say that this is, that there is some wisdom behind this by which Allah intends benefit for the majority or for the whole of mankind. But as it relates to us, we see that a man stealing is evil, or a man murdering somebody else is evil, and we can apply the same thing to all other types of evils and harms. But as it relates to Allah, then we see that from the wisdom in that is that Allah's hudud are established. So the thief is punished, the murderer is punished, and the idea of wisdom and justice, you know, is found, and through which the rest of the people are protected. Right? So we see that even though something might be evil as it relates to us, as it relates to Allah, then there is perfect wisdom. We can apply the same thing to all of the, what we call the disasters which take place, like the earthquakes and the volcanoes and the tsunamis and so on and so forth. No doubt as it relates to us, these are evil in the sense that they bring about harm upon the people and loss of life and loss of wealth and stress and anxiety. So as it relates to us, this is an evil which has occurred. But as it relates to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, within this action there is perfect wisdom and perfect justice and a far-reaching wisdom behind what he does and behind what he wishes. So the Shaykh says that everything in Allah's actions and in Allah's wish, in Allah's irada, whether it is something that is good or whether it is something that is perceived to be evil by us, then all of that has a far-reaching purpose and a far-reaching wisdom. And that wisdom is al-ibtila wal-imtihan. Al-ibtila wal-imtihan, which is to test the people. To test the people, to put them to trial, and to make tamyiz, to distinguish between the khabith and the tayyib. To distinguish between that which is vile and impure, and that which is wholesome and pure. And likewise, in order to reward the people for their righteous actions, and to punish the people for their evil actions. Now, meaning that these are some of the wisdoms, and these are some of the purposes behind Allah wishing what we perceive to be evil amongst the creation. So all of this wisdom goes back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah has never created anything which is pointless, or anything which has no purpose, or has no, you know, Allah hasn't created anything just for mere idle play. So this is how we understand this statement, or some of the meanings that arise from this statement, وَلَا يَكُونُ إِلَّا مَا يُرِيدُ, that nothing occurs except what he wishes, that everything comes under Allah's wish, or under Allah's power, nothing escapes from it, and we are not confused by these doubts of the people like the Qadariya, who denied that, you know, that mankind comes under Allah's will in terms of his actions, and who claimed that man creates his own actions, because they had this misconception. This misconception that, you know, how can man be judged, you know, if you know, unless he is completely independent to choose and do and act what he wishes outside of Allah's will and power. So they had a misunderstanding, as a result of which they made an error. And this is why Imam al-Tahawi, you can see here in the opening statements of his creed, you see that he's refuted the groups on the issue of Allah's names and attributes, وَلَا شَيْءَ مِثْلُهُ. We see that he's also refuted the people who claim that Allah's attributes have a beginning, or Allah's attributes have an end. And likewise, we see here Allah refuting the we see when he speaks about Allah's attribute here of irada, we see that Imam al-Tahawi, he is refuting the Qadariya who deny al-Qadr. And so this is the end of what has been said by Sheikh Salih al-Sheikh. And so Sheikh Salih al-Sheikh, he says that there are a number of issues around this statement. But first of all, he says that what are the proofs for this statement? The proofs are the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Insan, Surah 76, verse 30. Allah says, وَمَا تَشَاءُونَ إِلَّا أَن يَشَاءَ اللَّهِ, that you do not will except as Allah wills. Indeed, Allah, إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ عَلِيمًا حَكِيمًا. Indeed, Allah is all-knowing, all-wise. And likewise, he says in Surah At-Takwir, Surah At-Takwir is Surah 81, verse 29, وَمَا تَشَاءُونَ إِلَّا أَن يَشَاءَ اللَّهُ رَبُّ الْعَالَمِينَ, that you do not will except as Allah wills, the Lord of the worlds. And we see that here the Shaykh has used verses which mention Allah's Mashi'ah. Now we have two things. We have Allah's Irada and we have Allah's Mashi'ah. And we have to understand that Allah's irada is not entirely the same as Allah's mashi'ah. And when we say Allah's irada, there is a difference which will be explained shortly, inshallah ta'ala. But what we should understand, that when it comes to Allah's irada, when we speak of Allah's wish, so in order to make it clear in English, when we say Allah's irada, we will use the word wish, Allah's wish, or Allah's desire. And when we say Allah's mashi'ah, we will say Allah's will. Allah's will. Right? So to help us distinguish between the two things in English. So when we speak of Allah's irada is of two types. Allah's irada is of two types. Allah's irada is The first type is Allah's irada kawniya, al-irada al-kawniya. This refers to everything which occurs within the creation. Everything which occurs in the creation and takes place in the creation, it occurs by way of Allah's irada kawniya, meaning that Allah's wish that relates to the creation, that relates to everything besides Him. And so this is what we call the irada al-kawniya. And the other type of irada is the irada shar'iyya. Irada shar'iyya. And this is the irada, this is something that Allah wishes and desires from the servants that they fulfill and that they perform and that they abide by. Right, so we as Ahlul Sunnati wal Jama'ah, we distinguish between these two types of irada and we don't treat them to be the same. If we treat them to be the same, then this will lead us to the mistake and it will lead us to the foundation of the bid'ah of the Qadariya and the Mu'tazila who spoke of the bid'ah of al-Qadr. Right, we distinguish between these two types of irada. Allah has an irada, which is irada kawniya, as it relates to everything in the creation, and an irada, which is shar'iyya, which relates to the things which Allah requests and desires from His servants in terms of the commands and in terms of the prohibitions. So for example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He wishes for His servants to have iman, to have faith. He wishes for His servants to establish the prayer. He wishes for His servants to and desires from His servants to follow and obey the messengers. He wishes and desires from His servants that they honor and respect the parents, and so on and so forth, from all the other things which are desired in the Sharia. At the same time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He does not like from the point of view of the Sharia, He does not wish from the point of view of the Sharia, the irada shar'iyya, that a person become a disbeliever, or that a person choose disbelief, or that a person commit shirk, or that a person fall into disobedience, or that a person commit a major sin. However, so this is Allah's irada shar'iyya. However, Allah, from His irada kawniya, He will wish and will that a person actually fall into disbelief, or that a person accept iman, or that a person fall into a major sin, or that a person do a righteous deed. Right? So we distinguish between these two things. And so from one angle, we see that nothing occurs in Allah's creation, neither shirk, nor kufr, nor disobedience, nor iman, nor tawheed, nor obedience. All of these things are exactly the same as it relates to Allah's irada kawniya. Allah's irada kawniya. Everything which takes place is exactly the same as it relates to Allah's irada kawniya. The belief of a believer, the disbelief of a disbeliever, the shirk of a mushrik, the sin of a disobedient one, the righteousness of an obedient person, all of this comes under Allah's irada kawniya. But as it relates to Allah's irada shar'iyya, then this is separate and this is different, and Allah only wishes from His servants that which He has revealed to them through the books and the messengers of tawheed and the iman and the sunnah and righteousness and so on and so forth. So we make a distinction between these two types of irada. But what is the difference between irada and mashi'a? Okay, what is the difference? And basically, when we speak of Allah's mashi'ah, Allah's will, then it is the same as Allah's irada kawniya. Okay? These two words at this point can be used interchangeably. When we say al-mashi'ah, Allah wills something, then it only refers to those things which are from the affairs which are kawniya. So this then makes it equal to Allah's irada kawniya. So irada kawniya and Allah's mashi'ah are the same thing. So whether we say Allah wills in this case, or whether we say Allah wishes, right, then really they are the same thing, because they are relating to everything which takes place in the creation. But we cannot use the word mashi'ah to refer to Allah's irada shar'iyya. We don't say the mashi'a shar'iyya. There's no such thing, because Allah's mashi'a is only used for those things which take place in the creation. Only for those things which take place in the creation. Whereas Allah's irada, Allah's wish, what Allah desires, that can refer to, you know, things which take place, which He wills to take place, and things which He does not will to take place. Right? So Allah didn't wish, you know, He requested from Abu Jahl to become a believer. Right? So from his irada shar'iyya, he wanted Abu Jahl to become a believer. But from his irada kawniyya, which is the same as Allah's mashi'a, Allah's will, he did not will that Abu Jahl should come a believer. Okay, so we distinguish between these two. And so irada is not the same as mashi'a in every single respect. Rather, the irada kawniyya is Allah's mashi'a. And as for the irada shar'iyya, that does not, we cannot speak of that in terms of Allah's will. And so this is basically what we distinguish between these two things. And so after it's become clear to us that when we speak of Allah's irada kawniyya, that it is the same as the mashi'a, then we see that there are a number of verses which speak about Allah's wish. Allah says, وَمَا اللَّهُ يُرِيدُ ظُلْمًا لِلْعِبَادِ, that Allah does not wish for oppression upon His servants. And Allah says, يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ بِكُمُ الْيُسْرُ وَلَا يُرِيدُ بِكُمُ الْعُسْرُ, that Allah, that He wishes for you ease, and He does not wish difficulty upon you. These verses are speaking about Allah's irada shar'iyya, right? Meaning that by way of what Allah has revealed, the commands, the prohibitions, Allah does not want to burden you. Allah does not want to commit oppression upon you. Allah does not want to make things hard upon you and burden you. Rather, all of this refers to Allah wishing and wanting ease and benefit for His servants. And so, also we see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He mentions about some of the disbelievers. He says in the verse, وَلَوْ عَلِمَ اللَّهُ فِيهِمْ خَيْرًا لَأَسْمَعَهُمْ وَلَوْ أَسْمَعَهُمْ لَتَوَلَّوْا وَهُمْ مُعْرِضُونَ. Allah says that if Allah knew of any goodness in them, He would have made them to hear. I made them to hear the guidance. But if He had made them to hear, they would have simply turned away, and you know, they would have turned away. This shows here that this comes back to Allah's knowledge. Allah is speaking about a group of people, and Allah knows that there is no goodness in them. And so for that reason, He did not cause them to hear the guidance. So He did not will from His mashi'a, or from His irada kawniyya, He did not will them to hear the message. He didn't will it for it to occur. Why? Because He knew that if He had willed for them to hear the message, they wouldn't have listened anyway. They would have simply turned away. So what this proves and what this shows, this verse, is that whatever Allah wills will occur. Whatever Allah does not will, meaning with the Mashiach, will not occur. And it is also in Allah's knowledge that if He had willed something to occur with his will, then He would have known what would have happened. Okay, and then even if that thing never even happened in the first place, even if He never willed it in the first place. So all of this shows that Allah's mashi'a, Allah's will, which is the same as Allah's irada kawniyya, which is Allah's wish tied to the affairs of the creation, then this is tied to Allah's knowledge and His wisdom. It is tied to Allah's knowledge and His wisdom. What does this mean? This goes back to the point we mentioned earlier, that for example, if Allah wills for an earthquake or a tsunami or some kind of calamity or some sort of disease or whatever it might be, then Allah has willed that thing to occur with mashi'a, and Allah has wished for that thing to occur with the irada kawniyya. And this is tied to Allah's ilm, His knowledge, and it is tied to his wisdom, hikmah. It is tied to those affairs. And we see that as for the irada shar'iyya, meaning that which Allah wishes and desires from the servants that they perform, even though he might not will that they perform it, right? So Allah wishes from you, Allah wishes from a person, like we said about Abu Jahl, for him to become a believer. Yet Allah, or Abu Lahab for example, they wished for him to become a believer, yet Allah willed for him to never become a believer. Right? And all of this is, so Allah's will here, which is the Mashi'a, is tied to Allah's wisdom and his knowledge and his knowledge. So from this we see that when Imam al-Tahawi says wala yakunu illa ma yurid, wala yakun, that nothing occurs except what he wishes, what is he talking about? Which irada is he speaking about? Is it irada shar'iyya or irada kawniyya? Irada kawniyya. This is speaking about irada kawniyya. It refers back to the irada kawniyya. And from this we distinguish, as we said, the important point to take from this is that we distinguish between the irada shar'iyya and the irada kawniyya. And by not distinguishing between these two things, then we fall into the innovation and the mistakes of the people like the qadariyya, who could not distinguish between these two things, and they had a misunderstanding about what is the notion of justice, al-adl, as it relates to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the second point that the Shaykh explains here is that we can look at this thing from two points of view, from the point of view of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and from the point of view of the servant. So it's similar to what we said before, that when Allah wills a thing, or when Allah wishes a thing with his irada kawniyya, we see nothing but wisdom in that action. But as for the servant, when we see a servant, a servant has his wish as well. He has his irada, he has his mashi'a. And he does things according to his own mashi'a. Now it could be the case that Allah's irada shar'iyya, that Allah's irada, that when he requests something from the servant, and when he wills it from his irada kawniyya, that it happens that the servant's irada agrees with that, in the sense that a servant, he does something which agrees with Allah's wisdom. And it could be the case that it does not agree with what Allah has willed or what Allah has wished. To give an example, again, some of this is quite technical, and the best way to really explain it is to give examples. This is when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he wishes from a servant to write a will, for example. And so when he writes the will, there will be a certain wisdom behind that, which is that the wealth will be distributed according to his wishes, and there will be no disputes amongst the people who he leaves behind from his family. And so there's a wisdom behind that. And so this is something Allah has requested and wished from the servant. And then the servant, Allah may will, or he may wish from his irada kawniyya, that the servant, that he might do this or he might not do this. So he might write the will, or he might, his legacy or his will, or he might write it but do it upon injustice, meaning that he gives away more than one third of his wealth, or that he, leaves something from someone. So he basically does something which is incorrect. So in this case, even though Allah, in Allah's action, we say here that from the point of view of Allah's irada shar'iyya, meaning what Allah requests and wants from the servant, obviously there is wisdom, because everything in the Sharia there is wisdom. In terms of what Allah actually willed to happen from his mashi'a and his irada kawniyya, in fact what actually took place, which is whether the servant did or didn't write the will according to the right way, then whatever the case, in either of the two situations, yes he did, yes he didn't, then there is nothing but perfect wisdom in Allah's action. right? In Allah's mashia, in what Allah will to actually take place. And likewise in Allah's irada kawniya. But as for the servant, if the servant agreed with, if the servant in his intention, in his irada, he was intending that I am going to write the will according to, you know, the sharia and give everyone his due right, then here it happens, it has happened, that by way of Allah's irada kawniya, that the servant's irada and the irada of the sharia, it has come together. And if the man didn't, you know, write according to the sharia and he pressed somebody or whatever, then here there is no wisdom in that man's action. The wisdom has gone from that man's action, you know. And so even though in Allah's action there is still wisdom, do you understand? So we have to distinguish between all of these different situations, and you know, not to treat them as the same thing, because as we said before, not making these distinctions, it will cause us to fall into the mistakes of the Qadariyya. And so for this reason, the conclusion that we come to from this is that when we speak about Allah's action, then everything which takes place in His creation agrees with wisdom, with hikmah. Right? So this is the lesson that we're taking from this. Everything that He does that takes place as it relates to Allah, it is in agreement with wisdom, with hikmah. But that cannot be said about the actions of the servants. So as it relates to me and you, that when we do something, then it may or may not relate to hikmah as it relates to us and what we intend, as it relates to the fact that these are our actions. But as it relates to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then it is nothing but perfect wisdom. Again, to give an example, it may be the case that Allah establishes an evil ruler upon the people. This ruler oppresses the people, kills them, murders them, takes their wealth, imprisons them, beats them, and so on and so forth. Right? This action by the ruler is evil. This is evil on behalf of the ruler. And nothing that the ruler does can be said to be wisdom, as it relates to his actions judged by the sharia. As it relates to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then every single deed of that ruler, all of his murder, all of his killing, all of his oppression, all of his confiscating the wealth, imprisonment and everything, all of that, then we say that in all of that there is a far-reaching wisdom. Because there is nothing in Allah's creation that is not from His wisdom. Okay? So in other words, what we're doing here is that we're trying to separate and distinguish between the actions of the servants and what can be said about them, and the irada of the servant, and likewise the actions of Allah and the irada of Allah, which is irada shar'iyya and irada kawniyya. So everything which is from Allah's irada kawniyya, meaning that Allah's wish that relates to the created affairs, which is the same as mashi'a, then all of that is perfect wisdom. As it relates to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as it relates to the actions of the servants and their will and their wish, then we can't say the same thing, that there is wisdom in that, unless it agrees with Allah's irada shar'iyya. Unless it agrees with Allah's irada shar'iyya. So, the conclusion here then, from this, is that everything that is good is ascribed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, meaning that everything which takes place as it relates to Allah is goodness and wisdom. And evil is not to be ascribed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We don't say that Allah performs evil or Allah does evil. This cannot be ascribed to Allah's action. Rather, we say Allah creates evil, and in His action of creating evil, there is perfect wisdom and justice. That in Allah's action of creating evil, it is perfect wisdom and justice. But as for the evil, it exists only amongst His creatures and the created beings. But as for Allah, like when Allah, as we said, in all the examples that we gave, whether a thief steals, whether a murderer he murders, whether a ruler oppresses and kills and confiscates wealth, whether a tsunami takes place or an earthquake takes place, all of these are from Allah's actions. And in Allah's actions, each of those actions are perfect wisdom and justice. But as it relates to us, then the evil is found amongst us. So the the killing of a murderer is evil, the stealing of a thief is evil, you know, and so on and so forth, to all the other things that we find, diseases and other disasters, all of that we treat that to be evil as it relates to us. And so from this, Allah's irada is always in accordance with hikmah. This is what you should be writing down as the conclusion, that Allah's irada is tied to his ilm and hikmah. Allah's irada is tied to his ilm and his wisdom, to his knowledge and his wisdom. And so, whether that is, so in the Sharia, what we see in Allah's Sharia, all of the legislations and the commands, and all of that is perfect wisdom and justice. And likewise in what Allah wills to occur from his irada kawniyya, and what Allah wills to occur from his Mashiach, all of that likewise is from perfect justice. Nothing takes place except which is just and perfect wisdom, hikmah. All of that is tied. And the Shaykh says that, again, we have many other issues branching off from this discussion, like, for example, what is dhulm, what is oppression, what is justice, there's many other things to do with disbelief taking place and sin taking place, and you know, a man and his own actions, does he create them? All of these are separate issues. But because later on in At-Tahawi's creed, we see that Imam At-Tahawi discusses the issues of Qadr in a bit more detail, then these issues will be dealt at the appropriate point, in At-Tahawi's creed when we come to that, inshallah. But for now, the purpose here behind the statement, وَلَا يَكُونُ إِلَّا مَا يُرِيدُ وَلَا يَكُونُ إِلَّا مَا يُرِيدُ, that nothing takes place except what he wishes, then what we need to take away from here is, first of all, everything comes under Allah's wish. Nothing escapes Allah's wish. And by wish we mean Allah's irada. And Allah's irada itself is of two types, the irada shar'iyya and the irada kawniyya. And when it comes to mashi'a, when we use the word mashi'a, then by mashi'a, we do not treat it to be exactly the same as Allah's irada from every single respect. Rather, we say that there is Allah's irada shar'iyya, which is what Allah wants from his servants and requests from his servants, that they abide by the sharia. This is what we call irada shar'iyya. And then there's the irada kawniyya, which relates to what actually takes place. Right? So it's not the case that... it is not the case that Allah loves everything which he wills to take place. Right? So if Allah wills Abu Jahl or Abu Lahab to be disbelievers and to remain disbelievers, then it does not mean that Allah loves what he wills to take place. Rather, Allah dislikes disbelief. Allah dislikes shirk. Allah dislikes disobedience. So again, we have to be clear about these issues, that not everything that Allah wills from his irada kawniyya or from his mashiyya does he actually love. Right? So that's another issue, inshallah, that maybe we'll discuss when it comes later on. But these are some of the points that we should try to associate with this particular point of Imam At-Tahawi, وَلَا يَكُونُ إِلَّا مَا يُرِيدُ. I know that some of the issues here are quite technical and maybe difficult to grasp without lots of examples. But inshallah, if there's anything that's not unclear, then if you have any questions, we can address them, inshallah ta'ala. Otherwise, as we said, this issue is dealt later on in At-Tahawi's creed, where he discusses Al-Qadr in more detail. So maybe those issues will be expanded upon at the relevant point, inshallah ta'ala. So if you have any questions on anything that's been said, feel free to ask before we conclude.
Yeah. But not from Allah's irada sharia. Yeah. But the iman of Abu Bakr is from both Allah's irada kawniyya and irada sharia.
That's right, yeah. That's correct. So when we see, for example, that the kufr of Abu Jahl and Abu Lahab, that is from Allah's irada kawniyya, in that Allah willed it to occur and decreed for it to occur, and so it occurred. But it is not from Allah's irada shar'iyya. Right? So, things which are disobedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then we see that there is a departure between Allah's irada kawniyya and Allah's irada shar'iyya. Because Allah in his irada shar'iyya wants Abu Jahl to be, wanted Abu Jahl to be a believer, and Abu Lahab to be a believer, and a kafir to be a believer. Okay? But as it relates to, for example, Abu Bakr radiyallahu anhu, when he became a believer, then there is agreement between Allah's irada kawniyya and so in other words, the two types of irada come together. So Allah's irada kawniyya, Allah willed it to occur that Abu Bakr become a believer, and this is also something that Allah requested shar'an, meaning from the point of view of his legislation, from the point of view of what he requested from his believing slave. So those two things come together. So basically, in every single good deed of a believer, Allah's irada shar'iyya and Allah's irada kawniyya, they come together. They come together. But as for everything which is disobedience and disbelief and shirk and so on and so forth, then the two separate. So even though Allah wanted it and desired it from the point of view of the shar, from the point of view of the legislation which he sent to his creation, that he never actually, you know, even though he requested it, he never willed it to occur. Meaning he never willed it that a person abandon disbelief or become a believer or abandon disbelief and so on and so forth. So yes, that's the easy way to remember that in every deed of goodness, the two come together. And in every deed of disobedience, then the two separate. The two separate. Any other questions? All clear? Test you on it then, yeah? Okay. So, unless, what are the two types of irada then? Okay, what is each one? Yeah, rather sharia is what Allah requests from the servants. He wants the servants to abide by. This is Allah's irada shar'iyya. He wants everyone to follow the messengers and to worship him upon tawheed and so forth. This is irada shar'iyya. Whether it actually takes place or not, that's Allah's irada kawniyya. Right? And in everything that Allah does, there is far-reaching wisdom and purpose. So as we saw in what Sheikh Saleh Al-Fawzan said, he said that Allah creates evil and creates good for a wisdom. And behind all of that is that is to test the people, put the people to trial, right? And to separate the evil from the good and to reward the good and to punish the evildoers. So all of this really is kind of tied together, really. You have to get the complete picture by tying all of these issues together. And it comes back down to Allah not creating the creation, you know, without any purpose. Allah created for a wisdom, for a reason. And so he sent messengers and books which explain his irada shar'iyya, right, which explain to the servants what's required from them and what they ought to do and how they ought to behave and how they ought to worship Allah alone. This is what Allah wants from them. But from Allah's irada kawniyya, then, meaning in terms of what Allah wills to happen in the creation, then that in that there is perfect, complete wisdom, through which Allah, as we said, tests the people and separates the evil from the good and the and so on and so forth. So for that reason, not everyone is a believer. If Allah willed, everyone would have been a believer, but he never willed. And what's the reason for that? There's a far-reaching wisdom and a purpose behind that, which is what? Which is to raise the believers and to lower the disbelievers, and to, you know, to reward the righteous and to punish the sinful, and because that's the far-reaching wisdom behind Allah's creating the creation. So these affairs that take place amongst the creation of what we seem to be evil, what appears to be us to be evil, and Allah willing it to occur, like the disbelief of a disbeliever and the sin of a believer, all of that, there is a wisdom and a reason behind that, which all leads to, as we said, this great goal or this great objective, which is to test and to put the people to trial, and to put some into paradise and to put some into hellfire, and, you know, which Allah had already decreed when he took, you know, the souls of the son of Adam from Adam, and decreed a portion for the hellfire, and decreed a portion for, you know, for paradise. So
Allah gave, like, full choice to disbelieve it, to become
a, yeah, disbelieve. Everyone has full choice. No one feels compelled to do anything, right? And this we know, and we, you know, this argument against Al-Qadr is really futile. And the best way to argue against, you know, people who make this claim is really to give, like, two examples. And this is something that no one can really deny. The first example that you give is that if you had two routes or two journeys to arrive at a certain destination, and on the first route, if you went that way, you have highway robbers, there's no stops, it's long, it's windy, it's rocky, it's this and that, whatever, and you know, that's one way you can choose. And the second way, if you chose the second route, you find that it's the shortest route, people are nice, there are stops on the way, there is this, and you know, every person knows that he will be free to choose one or the other. These are choices that come to you every day in your life. And no one at any time feels that he has ever been forced to make a choice. Right? Everyone always chooses that which is going to be what they perceive to be good for them, what they perceive, and keep away from what they perceive to be evil from them. And so the idea of choice, everyone feels and knows that they have choice. No one can, not even a disbeliever can deny that they have complete, perfect choice in what they choose and what they do. That's the first thing. The second thing is that if someone if someone argued from the point of view of justice and oppression, then you could go to them and slap them in the face, put a rock through the windscreen, pour acid over the bonnet, burn their lawn, kill their dog. Not that I'm saying that you do that, but I'm just giving an example. And then you could do all sorts of oppression to them and say, Allah decreed for me to do that from Allah's Qadr. I was compelled. So there's no notion of justice and oppression, right? So you can't say nothing to me. You should just be happy with it, right? And of course, no one is going to really accept that line of reasoning. Not even a disbeliever is going to accept that line of reasoning. No one's going to accept that line of reasoning. Rather, he will know that there is an idea of justice present, which everyone, because this idea of justice, al-adl, and a notion of oppression, is something that's from the fitra. There are some things which are from the fitra. From the fitra is everybody knows that everything which is originated has an originator, right? This is something that everyone's fitra will immediately recognize. This is from the things that Allah has put within a soul and within the creation, in their fitra, that everyone knows that, you know, if a glass fell on the floor, it didn't fall on the floor by itself. Now, and if a glass is found on the table, it didn't come there by itself. Someone put it there, right? So every originated thing has an originator. Also from the things is that every soul knows it has inherently the notion of justice on oppression. Right, so if you just walked up to somebody on the street and just punched him in the face for no reason, then everyone who sees this, because they still have aspects of the fitra within them, they will know that this is injustice. This is wrong. That's why even the atheist, because that you still see aspects of the fitra coming through in an atheist even, right? He will know that justice, that injustice is injustice. He will know that. Right, but what we see with the atheist is that he tries to cover and bury that fitra, Okay, so but even though sometimes that fitra will come through and it will manifest itself in his behavior or in his speech. So even this idea of knowing something to be an injustice, then this is as we said in the fitra of all people. And so when you use this argument against even a non-Muslim or an atheist about this idea of justice and that there has to be responsibility for people in the actions, it's something that they can't deny. You know, so otherwise you give them that example that, you know, if I slapped you and, you know, did this and did that and the other, whatever, and damaged your property and whatever, then, you know, there's no such thing as justice. So how can you hold me responsible? You know, so you have no. So obviously that's what we call an argument for morality.
So from your choice, what is something that Allah will happen?
Yeah. You chose to do the action, but you are within Allah's complete power and control and mashi'ah. Nothing you do, it comes outside of Allah's mashi'ah. But Allah, in willing you to do that thing, there is a perfect wisdom in Allah's action, in willing you to do. So in the atheist being an atheist, right? Even though the atheist has chosen to be an atheist, right? Even though the proof is established against him by way of his fitrah, and by way of the messengers and books being revealed, right? So the hujjah is established upon him, right? And he's chosen his path, right? So it's perfect wisdom and justice that he enter the fire. So he can't argue from that angle, right? And as we said, he can't argue against the idea of justice either, and oppression either, because inherently he knows the idea of justice and injustice is real and true. By way of the example that I've given to you, that if you slap him in the face, you know, break his leg, you know, kidnap his cat or whatever else you want to do, and tell him that you've got no right to invoke any idea of justice or injustice, right? Because this is hypocrisy on your behalf, right? Because, you know, where do you get your idea of justice from and injustice from? There is nothing, you know. So he has to accept that there's an idea of justice and injustice, right? So that is, and so when it comes to Allah willing disbelief upon a person, or Allah willing sin upon a person, right? The person has complete choice to do that. A person is completely free to go and steal, to murder, to rape, to whatever, to, you know, to perform his obligations, not perform his obligations. No one feels compelled to do anything, right? A person doesn't say when he, for example, enjoys his food, oh, I was compelled to eat the food. He knows he desired and willed and wished to eat that food. He knows he chose and wanted to eat that food. So when it comes to the good things, you know, he will readily accept that, yes, I willed and I wished and, you know, I have a desire and I wanted to. So when it comes to good things, obviously now there is a will and a wish. And he knows that he's got the choice. And he feels and he knows he's got the choice to do that. When it comes to the evil he performs and creates, Allah forced me to do this. Allah wished to do this. Allah, you know, so we can see the hypocrisy as well, that in this argument there's a lot of hypocrisy. And really people follow the desires, whether they are sinful Muslims or whether they are atheists and disbelievers who try to invoke this idea of justice and injustice. So basically what we say is that in every single thing that Allah does, like what Imam Tahawi said, وَلَا يَكُونُ إِلَّا مَا يُرِيدُ, that nothing occurs except what he wishes. So, and his wish, his irada is tied to his ilm and his hikmah, his knowledge and his wisdom. And so everything, the disbelief of an atheist, the shirk of a mushrik, the kufr of a kafir, the belief of a believer, the righteousness of a righteous believer, all of that, there is perfect wisdom in everything. And so everything, the fact that one will get punished and one will get rewarded, all of that is perfect wisdom, perfect justice, is from Allah's adl. And there is no dhulm, oppression in any of that whatsoever, in any of Allah's actions. But there is dhulm in the actions of the servants. Anyway, so inshallah, maybe, you know, we will expand upon these issues when we come to the issue of Al-Qadr a bit later on. So with that, we conclude today's lesson, inshallah. And we'll continue next week with the next few statements, inshallah ta'ala. Oh, sorry, not next week, in a fortnight from today, because I think next week there will be a lecture, inshallah ta'ala, a public lecture by our brother Abu Idris from Birmingham. And so that will be at around 5 o'clock, inshallah, next week at the same venue. So everyone's, we encourage you to come and attend, inshallah, and bring your friends and family. And so, but the lesson will continue 2 weeks after that. And with that, subhanaka allahumma wa bihamdika ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta wa astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.